In this video, I'm going to be talking about UV photography, and specifically the purity of your light source, which is one of the most important factors that you need to consider if you're thinking about getting into this fascinating genre. So stick around, and I'll get started in just a sec. Hi guys, I'm Ben from Adaptalux, and welcome to another UV photography video. If you've been subscribed a while, you'll know that we've talked in depth about UV photography before. Today, I want to take a more in-depth look at specifically why purity is so important for UV IVF photography. That's ultraviolet-induced visible fluorescence photography. If you're not sure why that distinction is important, there is another type of UV photography. For an overview of those two different types and a bit more of a wider look at this genre, go and take a look at our video up here. It explains the difference between the two types, and it will give you a good idea whether this is something that you might want to pursue. Before we get started at our in-depth look, there is an important safety concern. Extended exposure to UV light can be harmful to your eyes. It's why all but the most budget sunglasses come with a UV coating on them to filter out that UV created by the sun. When we're creating our own UV, the hazards are the same. Don't go staring down the barrel of your UV LEDs or your UV flash. It's not good for your eyes. My eyeglasses actually have a UV coating on them. Yours might do too if you got them from an optician. You can always ask them if they put those kinds of coatings on there, and you can probably ask them too as well. So if you've got some reading glasses or eyeglasses or even sunglasses with a UV coating, make sure to use them when you're using your UV lights. If you don't have any of those, you can pick up some UV protective glasses online, pretty cheap, only a couple of pounds or a couple of dollars, and it'll just protect your eyes over a long period of time using UV. Now, with the safety briefing over and done with, let's check out a little bit more about purity of our UV light. I've come through into my kitchen to run a little experiment. It's going to involve these flowers, and it's going to involve a couple of different types of UV light source. Hopefully it will demonstrate the difference between a pure and an impure light source. Now, choosing a UV light source is probably one of the first hurdles that you'll come up against when you start thinking about how to get into UV IVF photography. The temptation would be to just go and grab a conventional, normal UV light source, probably one that you've seen around the place in other types of situations for other practical reasons. If you've ever been to a nightclub or perhaps a Halloween party, you will have seen a black light bulb that makes people's white shirts glow bright blue. Those are really cool, but they won't work for something like UV IVF photography. The same for things like forensic flashlights, UV flashlights that use UV LEDs. Although they're really powerful, they don't give you a pure light source. The power is a factor. It works much the same way as visible conventional light. The more power you have, the better settings you can have. That gives you a few more options in how you're going to take your image. What we think though is that the most important factor is that purity. And there's one simple reason for it, and that is the fluorescence. The way that fluorescence and UV IVF photography actually work is that we're not capturing any UV light at all. It's invisible, you can't see it with your eyes, you can't capture it with your camera. What we are capturing and seeing is visible light that is created by a particular subject when it's exposed to UV light. And that glow that you get from any particular subject, that is the fluorescence. So you'll hear of certain subjects being more fluorescent than others. Some of the ones that you might be aware of are the things that are so highly fluorescent that we can actually see them with our naked eye, with even the most impure lighting. So for example, our white shirt at the Halloween party, those white shirts, your linens will glow quite a lot, even under relatively low levels of UV light from the black light. Incidentally, that's actually because of the detergent that you wash those whiter than white sheets with. They add chemicals to make them just a little bit fluorescent so that when you're out in the sunshine, your whites actually are fluorescing ever so slightly, and it makes the white pop just that little bit more. So what difference does the amount of fluorescence from our subject make to our choice of UV light source and the purity of that light source? Well, it's all about balance. The subjects that we've talked about just now, our white shirts, things like quinine in tonic water, UV inks and paints, they all glow so brightly that you don't need to worry about any extra visible light. They will outpace no matter how bright your room is or how much impurity you have in your light source. They will always be bright enough for you to see both with your naked eye and with your camera. In a dark room, it might even be too bright and you'll be exposing for your brightly glowing white shirt and not for anything else. What that means is that you can pretty much go ahead and get any UV light source that you want if you solely want to capture those really brightly glowing objects. If you want to capture something a little bit more subtle, for example, these flowers, you're going to need to start to think about reducing the amount of visible light both in your shot, in your environment, and from your light source. Let me try and demonstrate this first using a little bit of visible light, and then we can take a look at the difference between a pure and an impure light source using UV. So for this little demo, I'm just going to capture the design on the side of this vase. It's nothing special, it's not even fluorescent, but I'm going to be using visible light to demonstrate the balancing of our UV fluorescence with more ambient light than we would like. I'm using pink as a sort of analog, a stand-in for our UV fluorescence. So when I have a pink color filter down here, this bottom lighting arm is going to be representative of our fluorescence. When you see pink in the image, that means that we've got a little bit of fluorescence going on. I also have a blue lighting arm here. That blue is going to be representing the impure light that comes from an impure UV light source. It will often show up as blue or violet, and that's a little bit confusing because the fluorescence can also sometimes show up as blue or violet, but you'll see what I mean in just a minute. This top light here is just a white lighting arm. It's going to represent the ambient light in our room. So if your room is too bright, it can easily overpower both the visible light created by your UV light source and the UV fluorescence created by your subject. Let me play with these light levels a little bit and see what happens if we turn out all of the lights in our room and reduce the amount of visible light contamination in our image simply by making the room dark. Now you can see at this point, things have changed a little bit. Things are a lot more colorful and bright and interesting. That's the first step that you're going to get when you get an impure light source. You're going to see these blues and purples and you're going to be like, oh my God, that looks really cool. However, what you're actually seeing here is still visible light just bouncing off your subject. It just happens to be really blue and really violet. The difference then between an impure and a pure UV light source is taking away that blue and violet light that is also created by your light source. So if I take away all of our blue light, you can see that we're left with only pink. Now, it takes a little bit of a stretch of the imagination to think of this pink visible light as our UV fluorescence visible light, but it's a good demonstration, I think, for the balance between all of these different factors. Now, if you've got a pure UV light source, but still got quite a lot of ambient light in the room, the effect will be the same, simply that everything is going to overpower that very minimal fluorescence from something like our flowers. Hopefully that little demonstration gave you the opportunity to visualize a little bit how important it is to remove all visible light from a scene. I say it every time we do a UV video. I mentioned how I have to turn off all of the lights in order to actually take the photograph, and I'll be doing that in just a moment as I photograph these flowers. I am going to photograph them with a pure light source, but I'm also going to photograph them with an impure light source. To demonstrate that, I've got this big UV flashlight. This is typical of something that you'd buy off Amazon in order to give UV IVF photography a go. It's very, very bright. It does make things glow. Things like our shirts and very, very fluorescent objects will glow nice and brightly under this thing. However, it also has a lot of visible light, so you can see where this is going. I think that visible light from this all of these many LEDs is going to overpower the fluorescence that we can get from our flowers. If I show you a very fluorescent subject, this is a little Star Wars cookie cutter, it glows an incredible amount under UV. However, I know for a fact that those cabinets behind me are not fluorescent at all and they shouldn't be showing up any color at all. However, when I shine my flashlight onto them, you can see a lot of blue, a lot of purple. The same for our flowers, a little bit of blue, a little bit of purple, not very much fluorescence, especially when compared to an actually very fluorescent subject. So you can see that we're going to need a lot of difference between our fluorescence and the ambient light in order to really pick up what fluorescence there is from our flowers. Let's jump in, take a look at what I can get using, firstly, my UV flashlight. So you can see from that first picture of my flower, it's quite stunning. There's a lot of color there, and it might be at first quite impressive to see all of those blues, those purples, and you might be thinking, wow, look at that UV photography. But what we've actually captured there is just violet and blue light. It's not the fluorescence from the subject itself. What we need to see, the fluorescence, is a pure UV light source. When I turn my lights out again and take another picture using my AdaptLux UV lighting arms, you'll see the difference between the details in my flowers and the color differences that are created solely by the fluorescence of the flower itself. Hopefully you can see there the difference between our pure UV fluorescence and our impure UV light. I'll put both of those flower pictures up on the screen, and you can see that one of them is far more saturated with blue color. That is essentially just blue LED light coming straight from the torch and bouncing back off the subject. It's not the fluorescence from the flower turning everything a lot more blue, and you can see the difference in contrast, the difference in the colors, and in fact you can see the difference in the fluorescence. Even the tiny little bits of dust, the hairs that are attached to the flowers, they seem like they're fluorescing far more than the flowers themselves, which aren't very fluorescent by comparison. But in our impure image, you can't even see those tiny little bits of dust fluorescing, because even those are overpowered by the blue visible light created by our UV flashlight. There is a big difference between these two images, and that's in the settings. One of them is taken on a much longer shutter speed. You get a lot better settings with those impure lights, but it's a little bit deceptive because the thing that's giving you those better settings, the shorter shutter speeds and the better f-stop numbers, is actually just visible light. It's just the same as leaving all of your lights on and taking a picture in the bright daylight. You're going to get better settings, but you're going to get less of that fluorescence by comparison. Now, this is not a review of this flashlight or any other UV flashlight. They simply are good for certain things and not so great at this very specific type of UV-IVF photography. Dimly fluorescent subjects are always going to be overpowered by even the slightest amount of visible light. Now, these are designed for finding those really bright fluorescing subjects. Things around your house, you can have quite a lot of fun walking around finding those bits of plastic that for some reason glow a little bit brighter than others. Paper, linens, they are quite fun. You can go around and play detective with your forensic flashlight and find those cool shots of very highly fluorescent objects. However, when it does come to taking those iconic pictures of flowers, insects, and the like, you're going to need a pure UV light source. We, of course, have our UV lighting arms, which are specifically designed for a pure UV light source. They have a bandpass filter in the end of them, which actually looks black because it's blocking all of the visible light coming both ways, which means any visible light still created by the UV LED is completely removed. Our flashlight has no such thing, so all of these LEDs are still creating a little bit of visible light and overpowering the fluorescence of a very dimly fluorescent subject like our flowers. You can modify flashes and flashlights similar to this one, but then you're not spending $10 on a flashlight anymore. It's more likely to be several hundred. And flash guns, although they're modifiable, it does require taking them apart, taking out some of the UV blocking filters and adding some visible light blocking filters. It does require a lot of expertise. I wouldn't recommend taking apart a flash unless you know what you're doing. With high voltage electronics, it can be a little bit dangerous. Hopefully my explanations today, my demo and these images at the end here have given you a little bit more insight into why the purity of your light source is an important factor if you're trying to get into UV-IVF photography. Now, if you have learned something, if you enjoyed the video, make sure to give me a like down below the video and leave me a comment whether you're just starting out with UV-IVF or you've been doing it for a while. I really want to know whether this information was useful to you, whether it was new to you, and whether you'd like to see more UV-IVF content in the future. Make sure to subscribe if you'd like to see more tutorials, ideas, and inspiration in the future. But for now though, guys, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.